Let's see how we can hijack or manipulate the behavior of a mouse. So we're going to have, let's say, four mice. First, I'm going to put a normal mice here. He's going to be a normal mice without any modification of any kind. So let's say here is the mice, like this. And we're going to take in some sample, some biopsy of the cells, of the neurons of these mice. So here, let's say this is inside of the neuron of this mouse. And when cells are active, we have some protein that is called CFOS. CFOS is a subrogate of activity in the cells, in this case of the neurons. And CFOS is a transcription factor. Transcription factor means that when CFOS, which is a protein, binds to some portion or some segment of DNA, it's going to be more easy that RNA polymerase comes to the DNA and doing transcription of some genes. But here, in these mice without any modification, we just have, if the neuron is active, we just have high amounts of CFOS, but the mouse doesn't have the response element, which is a sequence of DNA that binds to CFOS. Let's continue. Now let's suppose that we have another mouse. Here is another mouse. And now, in the neurons of the mouse, we are going to put some piece of DNA that contains two things. One contains the response element of CFOS, so it's called CFOS response element. Also, we are going to have the promoter, the CFOS promoter. And we are going to have the tetracycline, and we are going to have a fluorescent protein. So here we are going to have in the cells of the mouse, we are not just going to have the normal DNA or the normal genome of the mice, but we are also going to incorporate some other segments of DNA, and these segments are the promoter CFOS, the CFOS response element, the gene that encodes for tetracycline, and the genes that encode for a fluorescent green protein. So I'm going to put it. So I'm going to put the DNA here. Let's say this, which is in blue, is going to be the CFOS response element. So this sequence of DNA is going to be the site of binding of CFOS, which was this protein right here, so binding of CFOS. So in this piece of DNA, CFOS is going to bind. Next, we are going to have what is called CFOS promoter. Here is the CFOS promoter. And then we are going to have the genes that encodes for tetracycline. So this is the gene that encodes for tetracycline. And also, we're going to have the gene that encodes for fluorescent green protein. So let me put it here. Fluorescent green protein. So now let's see what happened. If this cell is active, it's going to produce greater amount of CFOS. So here is going to be CFOS. Then if CFOS is high, CFOS is going to bind to the CFOS response element, which is a sequence of DNA. So CFOS binds here to the sequence of DNA. And given that CFOS is bind here to the response element, it's more easy that the RNA polymerase comes here, binds to the CFOS promoter, and begins transcription of the genes that follow the CFOS promoter. So if RNA polymerase binds here to this promoter, it's going to transcribe what is next to the promoter, which are these two genes. The genes that encode for tetracycline and the genes that encode for a green fluorescent protein. So we're going to have here an RNA that encodes for the green fluorescent protein and the tetracycline. Then these are going to go to the ribosome. And then we're going to produce tetracycline. So let's say this is the tetracycline, many molecules of tetracycline. And we're also going to produce the green fluorescent protein. And the green fluorescent protein is the transmembrane protein. So once the cell produces the green fluorescent protein, it's going to be up here in the transmembrane. So now what happened? Now if the cell is active, this means that it's expressing a lot of CFOs. And if it expresses a lot of CFOs, then we have here in the membrane the green fluorescent protein, and we have a lot of tetracycline. So if we sacrifice the mice and we see the brain of the mice, we are going to use some kind of blue light in order to see this green fluorescent protein. If we want to see if we have a green fluorescent protein, we need to put a blue light. So let's say this is the brain, and we are going to put it under a blue light in order to see green the brain. So the areas of the brain that are active, that has high concentration of CFOs, they are going to be green. So let's say that this is a coronal section of the mouse brain, and let's say that these are the parts that are active. So in this part, we are going to see green when this is put under blue light, because if it is active, it expresses CFOs, and if it expresses CFOs, then this end up with production of green fluorescent protein. And if we have green fluorescent protein, that is meaning, or that is indicating to us, that we also have tetracycline. So we know that in this portion of the brain, we also have the tetracycline. So this was the second mouse. Now let's go to a third one. So now I'm going to erase this one. Now let's suppose we have the same mice, the second mouse that we have, and we're going to infect the mouse with a virus. So here's a virus, and the virus is a modified virus. In fact, it's an adenovirus. And instead of having the normal genome of the adenovirus, we are going to put some sequence of DNA. And the sequence that we're going to put here inside the adenovirus is going to be a response element of tetracycline. Also, we're going to put a promoter, another promoter, and we're going to put the gene that encodes for a red fluorescent protein, and also we're going to put the gene that encodes for a protein called rhodopsin. So now here, this is the virus, and inside of the virus we have the response element of tetracycline, or tetracycline response element, this one. Then we have a promoter, let's say this is the promoter for these genes. These genes are the red fluorescent protein, the gene that encodes for the red fluorescent protein, and the genes that encodes for the rhodopsin. This is called chloride channel rhodopsin. So now this is a virus, and we are going to inject this virus to the mouse, the second mouse that we have. So now let's say this is the cell, this is the neuron of the, no, let me put it bigger, this is the neuron of that second mouse. So like this. So we have the CFOs response element. I'm going to put first what we had in the previous mouse. So we have here, this was CFOs response element. Then we had the promoter. Then we have the gene that encodes for a green fluorescent protein. So this is the gene that encodes for the green fluorescent protein. Then we have the gene that encodes for the tetracycline. This is the gene that encodes for tetracycline. And then we are going to have this piece of DNA. So when the adenoviruses infect the neurons, this genome that we modified is going to insert here in the genome of the neuron of the mouse. So now we are going to have the same sequence here. So we have the tetracycline response element. So here is the tetracycline response element. Then we have another promoter in blue. This is another promoter. Promoter for the following genes, and the following genes are the genes that encode for a red fluorescent protein. Red fluorescent protein, and the gene that encodes for rhodopsin, which is chloride channel rhodopsin. This one for rhodopsin. And so now let's see what's happened. If this cell is active, it's going to produce high amounts of CFOS. So here we have high amounts of CFOS. If we have CFOS, then CFOS is going to bind to CFOS response element, which is a sequence of DNA. So here is CFOS binding to the CFOS response element. This makes more easy that RNA polymerase binds to CFOS promoter. And what is going to transcribe? The following genes to the CFOS promoter, which are the gene that encodes for the green fluorescent protein and the gene that encodes for tetracycline. So once CFOS binds here and RNA polymerase comes here, we're going to produce the RNA that encodes for a green fluorescent protein and that encodes for a tetracycline. So we're going to have here in the membrane, we're going to have green fluorescent protein. This is the green fluorescent protein, and we're going to have high concentration of tetracycline. Let's say this is tetracycline. And now, the second part, if we have high concentration of tetracycline, tetracycline is going to bind to its tetracycline response element, which is the sequence of DNA that we put here. So now tetracycline binds to the tetracycline response element, and this makes more easy that RNA polymerase comes here. So again, we have RNA polymerase, and it's going to bind to the promoter, and it's going to transcribe the genes that follow the promoter, which are the genes that encode for the red fluorescent protein and the chloride channel rhodopsin. So once we have the RNA that encodes for these two proteins, then the RNA goes to the ribosomes, and we have red fluorescent protein that is also a transmembrane protein. So we're going to have red fluorescent protein in the membrane, like this. This is the red fluorescent protein, and we're also going to have the chloride channel rhodopsin, and this is also a transmembrane protein. So whenever we have the red fluorescent protein, we're going to have the chloride channel rhodopsin. So this is the chloride channel rhodopsin. And chloride channel rhodopsin is, let's say, it's a channel. In this case, this is a channel specific for chloride. So if here we have a channel for chloride, chloride can get inside the cell when light is turned on. So when light is turned on, chloride can get inside the cell. And if chloride gets inside the cell, then the cell gets a less resting membrane potential. So the membrane voltage, or the voltage of the cell here, is going to decrease because chloride is a negative ion. So now if we have the CFOS response element, the CFOS promoter, the genes that encode for green fluorescent protein and tetracycline, and we have the tetracycline response element, promoter for the red fluorescent protein and chloride channel rhodopsin, we can manipulate the behavior of the mouse. How? Just putting some light. When we turn on the light, something is going to happen because chloride is going to get inside. If we turn off the light, then chloride is not going to get inside. But now the behavior of the mouse depends if we turn on or turn off the light. Now let's go to another mouse. It's going to be exactly the same mouse, like this one, just that what happens if we put in the food of the mice, we put doxycycline. Doxycycline is a molecule that inhibits tetracycline. So doxycycline inhibits tetracycline. So let's say if this mouse, some hours previous to the experiment, eats doxycycline, then what happens? If CFOS is high, CFOS is going to bind to the CFOS response element. If CFOS binds to the response element, it's easier that RNA polymerase comes and transcribes the genes that follow the promoter. So, green fluorescent protein and tetracycline. So here we are going to have tetracycline and the green fluorescent protein. But now that the mice eat doxycycline, here inside the cell we are going to have doxycycline. And doxycycline binds and inhibits tetracycline. So here, whenever we have tetracycline, it's going to be inhibited by doxycycline. So now tetracycline cannot bind to its response element. So if tetracycline does not bind to its tetracycline response element, then it's more difficult that RNA polymerase comes here and doing the transcription of these genes. So we are going to have less RNA that encodes for the red fluorescent protein and the chloride channel rhodopsin. And so we're going to have less chloride channel rhodopsin. And if we have less chloride channel rhodopsin, this means that whenever we put the light, the mouse is not going to respond, because we are not having this channel. So this is how we can control or hijack the behavior of a mouse just with light. So what does that happen? The mouse has high concentration of C4s, but it does not have the C4 response element. So we have a mouse, we put the C4 response element, and we put the C4 promoter, and we put the genes that encode for tetracycline and the green fluorescent protein. Why are we putting the genes that encode for green fluorescent protein? Because if we sacrifice the mouse, when we sacrifice the mouse and we put the brain under blue light, we are going to see green some parts, and if here is green, that means that those parts of the brain have tetracycline, so that means that we are right, that we have tetracycline. That's the reason for which we need to add this green fluorescent protein. And the reason for which we need to add the red fluorescent protein is that if in this mice, let's say in this mouse, before it's doxycycline, when it expresses the channel rhodopsin and also the red fluorescent protein, if we do, if we sacrifice the mouse and we put the brain under this case blue light and green light, then we are going to see some parts that look green because it expresses the green fluorescent protein, but also red because it expresses the red fluorescent protein. So this is going to look yellow. So in order to see a red fluorescent protein, we need to put the brain under a green light. In order to see green fluorescent protein, we need to put the brain under blue light. If we are going to see expression of both fluorescent proteins, we are going to put the brain under blue light and under green light, and we are going to see a combination of both of them, which are going to look yellow. So that means that here we have expression of the red fluorescent protein and also the channel rhodopsin. So why we are adding the fluorescent proteins? Not because they do something here in the cell, just because they are the indicators or the subrogates that we have tetracycline and that we have channel rhodopsin. See you in the next video.